Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Gopi Jana Balaba Girivara Dari. Gopi Jana Balaba Yashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana. Yashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana. Jamuna Tira Banachari. Jamuna Tira Banachari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunjabihari. Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha. Gopi Jana Balaba Girivara Dari. Gopi Jana Balaba Girivara Dari. Yashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana. Yashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana. Jamuna Tira Banachari. Jamuna Tira Banachari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari.
Jai Om Vishnupad Paramhamsa Parirava Chakchara Astho Thara Sata Shishi Mahi's Divine Grace Aboy Charanaravinda Bhakti Vedanta Swami Nantakoti Vaishnava Brindaki Namacharya Srila Haridasa Koriki Prem Sekaho Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Sivasari Gaura Bhakta Brindaki Shishi Radha Krishna Gopa Gopinath Shamakund Radhakund Girigo Vedanaki Vrindavan Dhamaki Mayapur Navadvip Dhamaki Jagannath Puri Dhamaki Gangamayiki Jamunamayiki Bhakti Deviki Tulsi Maharaniki Gaura Premanandi. Oh glories to the assembled devotees. Oh glories to the assembled devotees. Oh glories to the assembled devotees. Glories, oh glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 2, Chapter 9, Text Number 33. This is the first verse of the Chatushloki Bhagavatam, meaning this is the essence of the Bhagavatam. Bhagavatam spoken in four verses. It's a long purport, so we'll get into it. Hamivasam eva gre.
Nanyad
yatsad asat param. Paschad aham yadetachcha. Yovasishyeta sosmiaham. Hamivasam
eva gre.
Nanyad yatsad asat param. Paschad aham yadetachcha. Yovasishyeta sosmiaham.
Aham,
I, the personality of Godhead.
Eva,
certainly.
Asam,
existed.
Eva,
only.
Agre,
before the creation.
Na,
never.
Anyat,
anything else.
Yat,
all those.
Sat,
the effect.
Asat,
the cause.
Param,
the supreme.
Paschat,
at the end.
Aham,
I, the personality of Godhead.
Yat,
all these.
Etat,
creation.
Cha,
also.
Yaha,
everything.
Avasishyeta
remains.
Saha,
that.
Asmi,
I am.
Aham,
I, the personality of Godhead. Translation purport by Srila Prabhupada. Brahma, it is I, the personality of Godhead, who was existing before the creation, when there was nothing but myself. Nor was there the material nature, the cause of this creation. That which you see now is also I, the personality of Godhead. And after annihilation, what remains will also be I, the personality of Godhead. We should note very carefully that the personality of Godhead is addressing Lord Brahma and specifying with great emphasis himself, pointing out that it is he, the personality of Godhead, who existed before the creation. It is he only who maintains the creation, and it is he only who remains after the annihilation of the creation. Brahma is also a creation of the Supreme Lord. The impersonalist puts forth the theory of oneness in the sense that Brahma, also being the same principle of I, because he is an emanation from the I, the absolute truth, is identical with the Lord, the principle of I, and that there is thus nothing more than the principle of I, as explained in this verse. I. Accepting the argument of the impersonalist, it is to be admitted that the Lord is the creator I, and that the Brahma is the created I. Therefore, there is a difference between the two I's, namely the predominator I and the predominated I. Therefore, there are still two eyes, even accepting the argument of the impersonalist. But we must note carefully that these two eyes are accepted in the Vedic literature, Katha Upanishad, in the sense of quality. The Katha Upanishad says, Nitya Nityanam Chetanas Chetananam Eko Bahunam Yo Vidadati Kaman. The Creator I and the Created I are both accepted in the Vedas as qualitatively one because both of them are Nityas and Chetanas. But the singular I is the Creator I, and the created eyes are of plural number because there are many eyes, like Brahma and those generated by Brahma. It is the simple truth. The father creates or begets a son, and the son also creates many other sons, and all of them may be one as human beings, but at the same time, from the father, the son and grandsons are all different. The son cannot take the place of the father, nor can the grandsons. Simultaneously, the father, the son, and the grandson are one and different also. As human beings, they are one, but as relativities, they are different. Therefore, the relativities of the creator and the created, or the predominator and the predominated, have been differentiated in the Vedas by saying that the predominator eye is the feeder of the predominated eyes, and thus there is a vast difference between the two principles of eye. In another feature of this verse, no one can deny the personalities of both the Lord and Brahma. Therefore, in the ultimate issue, both the predominator and predominated are persons. This conclusion refutes the conclusion of the impersonalist that in the ultimate issue, everything is impersonal. This impersonal feature stressed by the less intelligent impersonalist school is refuted by pointing out that the predominator I is the absolute truth and that he is a person. The predominated I, Brahma, is also a person, but he is not the absolute. For realization of oneself in spiritual psychology, it may be convenient to assume oneself to be the same principle as the absolute truth, but there is always a difference of the predominated and the predominator, as clearly pointed out here in this verse, which is grossly misused by the impersonalists. Brahma is factually seen face to face his predominator Lord, who exists in his transcendental eternal form even after the annihilation of the material creation. The form of the Lord, as seen by Brahma, existed before the creation of Brahma, and the material manifestation with all the ingredients and agents of material creation are also energetic expansions of the Lord. And after the exhibition of the Lord's energy comes to a close, what remains is the same personality of Godhead. Therefore, the form of the Lord exists in all circumstances of creation, maintenance, and annihilation. The Vedic hymns confirm this fact in the statement, Vasudevo va idam agra asin na brahmana cha sankara eko narayana asin na brahma neshana, etc. Before the creation there was none except Vasudeva. There was neither Brahma nor Shankara. Only Narayan was there and no one else, neither Brahma nor Ishan. Sripad Shankaracharya also confirms in his comments on the Bhagavad Gita that Narayan, or the personality of Godhead, is transcendental to all creation, but that the whole creation is the product of avyakta. Therefore, the difference between the created and the creator is always there, although both the created and creator are of the same quality. The other feature of the statement is that the supreme truth is Bhagawan, or the personality of Godhead. The personality of Godhead and his kingdom have already been explained. The kingdom of Godhead is not void, as conceived by the impersonalists. The Vaikuntha planets are full of transcendental variegatedness, including the four-handed residents of those planets, with great opulence of wealth and prosperity, and there are even airplanes and other amenities required for high-grade personalities. Therefore, the personality of Godhead exists before the creation, and he exists with all his transcendental variegatedness in the Vaikuntha lokas. Vaikuntha lokas, also accepted in the Bhagavad Gita as being of the Sanatan nature, are not annihilated even after the annihilation of the manifested cosmos. Those transcendental planets are of a different nature altogether, And that nature is not subjected to the rules and regulations of material creation, maintenance, or annihilation. The existence of the personality of Godhead implies the existence of the Vaikuntha Lokas, as the existence of a king implies the existence of a kingdom. In various places in Srimad Bhagavatam and in other revealed scriptures, the existence of the personality of Godhead is mentioned. For example, in Srimad Bhagavatam 2.8.10, Maharaj Prikrit asks, Sachapi yatra purusho vishvastitya udbhavapyayaha muktvat ma mayam mayeshaha sete savaguhashayaha. How does the personality of Godhead, the cause of creation, maintenance, and annihilation, who is always freed from the influence of the illusory energy and is the controller of the same, lie in everyone's heart? Similar also with the question of Viduras. Tatvanam bhagavams tesham katida pratishankramaha tatrimam ka upashiran ka usvid anuserate. Sridhar Swami explains this in his notes. During the annihilation of the creation, who serves the Lord lying on the shesha, etc.? This means the transcendental Lord, with all his name, fame, quality, and paraphernalia, exists eternally. The same confirmation is also in the Kashi Kanda of the Skanda Purana in connection with Dhruva Charita. It is said there, Nachayavante piyat bhakta mahatyam pralaya padi ato chuto kile loke sa eka savago vyaya. Still two more pages to go. Even the devotees of the personality of Godhead are not annihilated during the period of the entire annihilation of the material world, not to speak of the Lord himself. The Lord is ever existent in all three stages of material change. The impersonalist adduces no activity in the Supreme, but in this discussion between Brahma and the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Lord is said to have activities also, as he has his form and quality. The activities of Brahma and other demigods during the maintenance of the creation are to be understood as the activities of the Lord. The king or the head executive of a state may not be seen in the government offices, for he may be engaged in royal comforts. Yet it should be understood that everything is being done under his direction and everything is at his command. Personality of Godhead is never formless. In the material world, he may not be visible in his personal form to the less intelligent class of men, and therefore he may sometimes be called formless. But actually, he was always in his eternal form in his Vaikuntha planets, as well as in other planets of the universes as different incarnations. The example of the sun is very appropriate in this connection. The sun in the night may not be visible to the eyes of men in the darkness, but the sun is visible wherever it has risen. That the sun is not visible to the eyes of the inhabitants of a particular part of the earth does not mean that the sun has no form. In the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad 1.4.1, there is the hymn, Atmevedam Agra Asit Purusha Vidaha. This mantra indicates the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, even before the appearance of the Purusha incarnation. In the Bhagavad Gita 15.18, it is said that the Lord Krishna is Purushatam, because he is the Supreme Purusha, transcendental even to the Purusha Kshara and the Purusha Kshara. The Akshara Purush, or the Mahavishnu, throws his glance over Prakriti, or material nature, but the Purushatam existed even before that. The Brihadaranyaka Upanishad therefore confirms the statement of the Bhagavad Gita that Lord Krishna is the Supreme Person, Purushatam. In some of the Vedas, it is also said that in the beginning only the impersonal Brahman existed. However, according to this verse, the impersonal Brahman, which is the glowing effulgence of the body of the Supreme Lord, may be called the immediate cause, but the cause of all causes, or the remote cause, is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The Lord's impersonal feature is existent in the material world because by material senses or material eyes, the Lord cannot be seen or perceived. One has to spiritualize the senses before one can expect to see or perceive the Supreme Lord. But he is always engaged in his personal capacity And he is eternally visible to the inhabitants of Vaikuntha Loka, eye to eye. Therefore, he is materially impersonal, just as the executive head of the state may be impersonal in the government offices, although he is not impersonal in the government house. Similarly, the Lord is not impersonal in his abode, which is always Nirasta Kuhakam, as stated in the very beginning of the Bhagavatam. Therefore, both the impersonal and personal features of the Lord are acceptable, as mentioned in the revealed scriptures. This personality of Godhead is very emphatically explained in the Bhagavad Gita in connection with the verse Brahmanohi Pratishtaham, Bhagavad Gita chapter 14, text number 27. Therefore, in all ways, the confidential part of spiritual knowledge is realization of the personality of Godhead and not his impersonal Brahman feature. One should therefore have his ultimate aim of realization not in the impersonal feature, but in the personal feature of the Absolute Truth. The example of the sky within the pot and the sky outside the pot may be helpful to the student for his realization of the all-pervading quality of the cosmic consciousness of the Absolute Truth. But that does not mean that the individual part and parcel of the Lord becomes the supreme by a false claim. It means only that the conditioned soul is a victim of the illusory energy in her last snare. To claim to be one with the cosmic consciousness of the Lord is the last trap set by the illusory energy, or Daivi Maya. Even in the impersonal existence of the Lord, as it is in the material creation, one should aspire for personal realization of the Lord. And that is the meaning of Paschat Aham Yede Tachcha Yo Vasistyeta So Smiaham. Brahmaji also accepted the same truth when he was instructing Narad. He said, Soyam te bihitastata bhagavan vishva bhavanaha. There is no other cause of all causes than the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari. Therefore, this verse, Aham Eva, never indicates anything other than the Supreme Lord, and one should therefore follow the path of the Brahma Sampradaya, or the path from Brahmaji to Narad to Vyasadeva, etc., and make it a point in life to realize the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari, or Lord Krishna. This very confidential instruction to the pure devotees of the Lord was also given to Arjuna and to Brahma in the beginning of the creation. The demigods like Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara, Indra, Chandra, and Varuna are undoubtedly different forms of the Lord for execution of different functions. The different elemental ingredients of material creation, as well as the multifarious energies, also may be of the same personality of Godhead, but the root of all of them is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna. One should be attached to the root of everything, rather than bewildered by the branches and the leaves. That is the instruction given in this verse. Omigyantam rantasya gananjana shalakaya chakshusha militam jena tasmai shri guruve namaha. I was born in the darkest of ignorance, and my spiritual master, he forced my eyes open with the torchlight of transcendental knowledge. Therefore, I offer my respectful obeisances unto him. I. Who am I? I am the one. I'm the hoochie coochie man. I am what I am. We're all searching for identity. This is the actual beginning of knowledge. Sanatana Goswami, he spoke to Lord Chaitanya when he first met him. People praise me as a learned scholar. I know Persian, I know Sanskrit, I know so many different languages, and I'm able to speak. I've got two arms, I've got two legs, I'm acting like a human being, I look pretty smart, I can dress well, I'm socially adept. But who am I? Why am I suffering? Where have I come from? Where am I going to go? What's the purpose of life? So Brahma was in the same quandary. He's born on the top of the lotus flower. and it's all darkness. Who am I? What's going on? So after searching around and not finding any answers, he shinnies down the lotus stem and starts swimming around in the water for a long time and doesn't get anywhere. Another great devotee, Markandeya Rishi, he was swimming around in the waters of devastation. Actually, he was where he was, and then suddenly he was inundated in these waters because he had this little desire. I'd like to see the Lord's illusory energy, the potency which bewilders. So he was in this ocean, he was swimming around for a long time, and wow, I'm bewildered, I'm lost. How am I going to get out of here? And suddenly he noticed on a leaf, a banyan leaf, a little baby, blue boy, Krishna, lying there sucking his toe. And then everything disappeared. The illusory energy disappeared. So Lord Brahma, he's down there and he comes back up and he still hasn't found the answer. Who am I? What's the purpose of life? So he sits there on the lotus flower and meditates. And suddenly there's this voice, tapa, two syllables, tapa, tapa. One who's versed in Sanskrit is the mother of all tongues, those two syllables, you put them together, they equal perform austerity. Tapa, so he's meditating, perform austerity, that's the answer, perform austerity. Who am I? You'll never know unless you perform some austerity, perform some penance. Lord Brahma now has seen the Lord face to face. His desired object of worship and meditation is there, and Lord Brahma, he feels the urge to create. It's his inherent nature. He's in charge of the mode of passion. He's invested with that quality to create. So he asks the Lord. The Lord appears in front of you. You could say, well, get me out of here. You could say so many things. There was a woman, she was a devotee of some sorts, and she was walking along the bank of the river, and she had this big bundle of wood, and it fell off, and somehow or other the Lord appeared before her. The Lord said, okay, I'm the Supreme Lord, how can I help you? So she asked, can you help put the lump of wood back on my shoulder? I'm having trouble getting along the path. But if you've got the Supreme Personality of God, if you've got a wealthy person in front of you, you don't ask for some petty, small time, insignificant thing. You ask for something that's relevant to your ultimate situation. You have to be able to gather your wits and take advantage of the situation. So Brahma, he's about to create. He approaches the Lord and he inquires, please explain to me how the creation is manifested. You're the ultimate creator. I want to act following in your footsteps. I want to follow you. I'm the secondary creator, and if you don't give me clear direction, if you expect me to do the job without properly informing me, that's the business of the parampara system. I had a little experience of that a couple of days after joining the temple. Basic bhakta training is to go and wash the pots. So I was put into cleaning up all the pots from the deity kitchen. Here the cook has to wash all the pots. But in Melbourne Temple, I don't know how long it took. It took me about 2 or 3 hours. There's a lot of pots and a lot of cleaning and the benches and everything like that. So I was thrown in there. And I thought, it might have been 9 o'clock at night after the late offering. And I thought, I've done a pretty good job. Went to bed, took rest. And the next morning, somebody came and woke me up and said, can you get back in there and do it again? It's useless. You didn't do it properly. Nobody had trained me up. Nobody had given me access to the secret of how to properly clean. And then slowly, without being properly trained, I noticed other people, the way they would clean, that the big pots, Ananyabak used to come out and he'd put the pots down and he'd get a hose, a hot hose, and he'd first off rinse them all off, and then you go into finer detail. Jamuna, in her first connection with Srila Prabhupada, she was put in a similar situation. She came to help. I'm a good cook. I'm capable. And Prabhupada said, "Yeah, fine, you can help, but this pot's a little bit dirty. Can you clean it up for me?" So she scrubbed and scrubbed and scrubbed, and then she brought it back to Prabhupada and said, "Is that okay?" And then Prabhupada said, "Well, there's just a little bit more over here. Can you just get to that?" And she went back and scrubbed and scrubbed and scrubbed and realized it was more and more, and just kept on. So he, in that way, trained. The parampara trained. Be perseverant. Pay attention to detail. Get to the bottom of it. Follow a regulated procedure. Do it properly. And you'll get the result. The plots, when they're cleaned properly, they're shiny. And they're nice to cook in. And so therefore, the cook's in a nice attitude. And the preparation offered to Krishna will be accepted. If you cook an offering, if you're cooking for the Lord, and you don't clean up after yourself, Srimati Radharani, she comes into the kitchen, she inspects the place. Oh, it's not fit for being offered. It won't be accepted as nicely as if the attention to detail has produced that proper, clean atmosphere. So Lord Brahma, he wants to create properly. He wants to do his job properly. So he's asking the Lord, please explain to me, what's the process? So this first verse of 4 clearly establishes where everything comes from. I, it's me, Krishna, aham, 3 times in the verse, aham, it's from me. I, the personality of God, I'm there before the creation. Before the creation, the whole universe is in a state of avyakta, unmanifest. It's technical. There's the pradhan, the unmanifested material energy that starts to coalesce and becomes the mahatattva. Then from the mahatattva, which is a little cloud in the corner of the, then it starts to manifest, and variegatedness starts to develop. But at one stage in the creation, all of the different elements were being created, but they weren't becoming animated. They were not being active until the Lord glanced over it, and his time potency and the personality of God, he actually activated. So he's the essential factor of everything. So before it's all put together, it's in an unmanifest state, we can't see, still the Lord is present. The example is given of the sun. When it's dark, we don't see the sun, but the sun exists elsewhere. And one who's not in darkness can perceive the sun, can perceive. So the Lord is there. And he's explaining to Brahma that before the manifestation, I was existing. Nothing else, nobody else. No Brahma, no Shiva. Nobody was existing. Then at the manifestation, everything is me. It's me. I exist. Nothing else is factual without the presence of the Supreme Personality of God. Just like in the hearts of all living entities, there's two souls. There's the individual soul and the super soul. The super soul always accompanies the individual soul in its journey through the material manifestation. The super soul, as the representation of the Supreme Personality of God, is only required in the material atmosphere. When you go back to the spiritual world, you meet the Supreme Personality of Godhead directly. The Paramatma, the super soul, is described to be like there's a circus coming to town. It's a temporary big event. In India, it's big. The Kumbh Mela comes to town. 70 million people congregate on the bank of the Ganges, like an empty plain. That gets turned into a big city. Some of its facility and electricity and roads and there's a personality who's put in charge, the superintendent of that festival. So the Paramatma, that form of the Supreme Personality, in the heart of all living entities, is put in charge. He's there personally following along, taking care of, giving instruction, taking care of the individual. So When there's life, it means the soul and the super soul are there. When the soul leaves, then the super soul is no longer required there in that place. So here in the manifested stage, in the Supreme Personality of God, he's manifested. If we can't see him, if we can't hear him, that's intuition, that's paying attention to instructions we've heard, that's been confirming our realization. If we're not hearing him, then we're just in darkness. And David Ritterswami gives the example. It's dangerous to be in darkness. It's dangerous to be driving down the road and the windscreen covered in mud. Like, there's been so much mud around and more mud gets generated just as you're driving through. So if you're driving down the road and the windscreen's dirty, it's dangerous. You'll have an accident. I was driving to Newgokul Farm one evening. It was dark and there was an incredible... No, it was still. Sometimes you drive there and the storm is... The rain's going sideways. It was incredible. And the lightning and it's light. This time it was calm, it was peaceful, it was pure dark. And I was driving down a little back road and I thought, oh, it's dark. So as I was driving along the road, I turned my lights off. And it became worrisome. The road was straight. I did it in a careful manner. But that darkness, that impenetrable darkness, that total darkness, it's frightening and dangerous. It's said that spiritual realization, Krishna consciousness, is just like the sun. Maya Suya Andhakar. Yahan Krishna Ta. When you're looking for yourself, you're trying to understand yourself, and it's dark, you can't differentiate. It's dark, it's dangerous. You're in a dark room and you'll trip over things and I thought it was there, but if you turn on the light switch, then everything gets illuminated and you can see the room and you can see yourself. So self-realization is a process of seeing Krishna and seeing yourself simultaneously. The self, devoid of the concept of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is still darkness. It's illusion. It's a partial understanding of the reality. And then Krishna is emphasizing also at the end of the creation, after it's all wound up again, I'll still exist. And there's a description here in the purport of the Vaikuntha lokas. They're in a different realm, the spiritual world. They're eternally existing. Just because we can't see them, just because we're not hearing, just because we're not in direct contact with them, doesn't mean they don't exist. Before you want to go and visit another country, you have to do some research. I'm off to the Ukraine. What language do they speak there? Is it safe to go there at the moment? Who will I meet? What currency do they use? Have they got any food? What do they eat there? So before you have to find out, you have to inquire, you have to make some... So that's the process of self-realization. That's the Lord Brahma, he's asking the Supreme Personality, he's asking his teacher, his guru, who am I? Where am I going? What's the purpose of life? Why am I suffering? And then with proper guidance, then one can traverse that dangerous path with less accidents. It's said that the path back home to Godhead is sharp, like the edge of a razor blade. It's very narrow, very precise. And when you're using a razor, if you're not careful, then blood will come. So you have to be very, very aware, very conscious. The acharyas, by following the acharyas, they turn that razor-sharp edge, that narrow path, into a six-lane highway. Their lotus feet become shelters. It expands so that by putting your feet, following in the footsteps of the previous acharyas, following the parampara, having access to that solid, confirmed, authorized, regulated message, then still be, it said, even on the royal road, we shouldn't be on the royal road. The royal road's maintained. There's guards. The cricketers went to Pakistan and it was like royalty was there. There was all sorts of guards, 400 or 4,000 police just guarding the streets so they wouldn't. But still, an accident can happen. So even you're on that royal road, we shouldn't become complacent. We shouldn't become lured by sense gratification, because an accident can happen. Once we've taken shelter of the Supreme Personality of God, once we've taken shelter of the spiritual master, once we've taken shelter of devotional service in the process, then it's never lost. A little bit of advancement, there's no diminution. And one should not fear. Concern and preparedness, awareness, but the ultimate goal will be reached. Even if we have to take a back step, even if we have to go into another realm of suffering, if you commit some offense against the Sankirtan movement, then you might have to see hell. You might have to become oblivious to the process of Krishna consciousness. Krishna is jnanam apohanam cha. He can give knowledge, he can give forgetfulness, and he can give remembrance. It's coming from Krishna. If we want to forget him, the only way we can forget Krishna is if he allows us. And I've met devotees who were in the temple and they haven't been in the temple for a while, and they were bewildered. I asked them, when was the last time you tried some halva? And they thought, can't remember. Never thought to just put a bit of butter and a bit of semolina and some sugar and make up this incredible preparation, offer it to Krishna, and then just experience his mercy. It's called the secret weapon. It's one of our secret weapons, the prasadam weapon. So, but they get bewildered and it's too fatty, it's not healthy, I don't deserve. But Krishna, he wants to bring all of the living entities, all the parts and parcels back to him. And that's why he is manifested in the form of his representative, the spiritual master. He's manifested in the form of the scriptures. He's giving these clear indications so that we can confidently progress on the path back to Godhead. There's a lot of other features in this purport, but I thought we'd read it to get through it. Somebody might like to revisit it going back. The arguments against impersonalism, and then the first part there's always two. It's never one. They're the same in quality, but there's one who is the predominator and there's the other predominated. We're not the absolute truth. We're persons, nitya, nityanam, chetanas, chetananam. There's the one supreme eternal, nitya, who is looking after, who's feeding chetananam, chetananam, feeding all of the other eternals. So we're one, in a sense, in terms of quality, but in quantity we're different. And the purport even also mentions that, and this is from the Acharyas, Jiva Goswami, that it may be useful in the interim to examine the nature of reality in an impersonal fashion, that the energy is all pervading, like the air within a pot and the air outside of the pot. They're of the same nature. But if you take that to the next stage, which the impersonalists do, that if you break the pot, then the airs merge. That's an incorrect use, a misunderstanding of that principle. This information is given in certain forms. But if we interpret the language, now here Narayan is supreme, he's more superior than Krishna, then we're misinterpreting. We shouldn't become attached to our particular understanding of philosophy. We should always check. We should also always double check and see, is this the way the steady devotees, is this the way they're practicing? Oh, I heard that. Okay, you can adjust. You can deviate a little bit. This and this. This is in some zones it was saying, well, four regulative principles. They're pretty tough. We can follow three, in great detail. But the fourth one, we need to be a little bit more lax in that. That's a deviation. And there are ways of following the principles without dropping the principles. The Acharya can change the principles. Srila Prabhupada, he introduced rather than 64 rounds a day, maximum. Minimum 16 rounds Hare Krishna mantra per day. We can't adjust that. If we're sick, we can still chant. We've lost our voice. You put Prabhupada chanting on, and you finger your beads, and Hare Krishna 16 rounds. You can considering time, place, and circumstance, you can follow the principles without deviating from the principles. But to change the principles, that's a philosophical fall down. A sensual fall down can be excused. A philosophical fall down, a philosophical deviation, very difficult to excuse. And so, like Sarvadhamam Prityagya Mame Kam Sharanam Braja Aham Tvam Sarva Papabhyo Moksha Shyami Masucha. I will deliver you from all sinful reactions. Sins are easy. Sins are easy in an instant. Vishvaheda was in the park walking around with Prabhupada in Melbourne. And he said, Prabhupada, I'm so sinful. How am I ever going to surrender? Prabhupada turned to him and said, you don't know? Krishna says he can deliver you in an instant from sins. But offences, they're of a different nature. You might have to go to hell. You might have to experience some, because offences and an offensive philosophical understanding, an offensive mentality, that's difficult to unravel. You commit an offence to the holy name, you take shelter of the holy name. You commit an offence to the devotees, you go and beg for forgiveness from the devotees. Other, the 10 offences, the Harinam Chintamani, it lists different ways. If you have an offensive thought towards the scriptures, you study the scriptures properly. Sometimes you have to announce in front of everybody, well, I'm sorry, please forgive me for my offence. But other times you just have to adjust your behaviour. The chanting Hare Krishna, you commit offences to the holy name, you just keep chanting the holy name, but you beg for forgiveness. Jagai and Madai, they realised that they'd been committing so many sinful activities. The Lord Chaitanya, Lord Nanda, they forgave them, but they weren't satisfied. So they asked, we're still feeling as though we've done something. So they were advised, dig a gut, Jagai gut, Madai gut, and go there and serve the devotees. And they would serve the devotees. They would give them fresh clothes. They would clean the steps. They would clean the place where they bathe. Then they'd give them money. They'd try and appease the devotees that they committed offences to. So, fine understanding and the ultimate understanding, one should be attached to the root of the tree, not to the branches and the leaves, not the flowery language of the Vedas. One has to understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and one has to serve Him. For one who is committed to forming devotional service, then I will give the understanding. I wish they can come to me. To Krishna. The devotee is the representative of Krishna, that he always has to give Krishna. He always has to, I'm Lord Brahma. I'm the secondary creator. Please instruct me. I can do my job, but I have to recognize that you are the ultimate cause. The remote cause. So as I said, there's a lot in this verse. It's technical. It's good to read them in association with the other three verses and to see that in a nutshell, that picture of Bhagavatam. But it's a gradual process of unraveling, a gradual process of realization, step by step. We should be committed to stepping on that path, to not avoiding the path. Oh, that's like I can get to the top of the building. There's the elevator. I'm going to take the stairs. I'm going to trudge up the 2,000 steps and get there. No, jump in the elevator. Push the button. Back to Godhead. Does anybody have any questions? Okay, we've got a microphone here. Vasu and then Yadavendra.
Transcendental even to the Purusha.
Thank you. You just described that kshara means eyes and glancing. He's distance. He's distant. He's by his glance he manifests. He's superior. We have to employ other means to create. We can't create progeny without a mechanical process. But Krishna, he can from a distance. He can glance. So he's the supreme person. He's the one who's pushing all the buttons. Like there's another example, another analogy of the king. Just because the king's not there, you don't say, okay, the king's gone out, he's in the bathroom or something like that, let's get up to all nonsense. Still, under his command, everything is going on. The kingdom still exists while the king is in power. Come forward. You've got to use the microphone. My wife's from Lithuania, and their language is known as an Indo-European language. So that has its basis in Sanskrit. They have these fire god, Agni. They do different sacrifices like that. I believe that the Chinese language, there's no character, no word for God. It's an impersonal. That's all I understand.
Yeah,
so everything comes from the Vedas, everything comes from Sanskrit, and they've employed those different terms, fighting, street fighting, grappling, so that's based on the martial arts system set up in the Vedas. Fair enough, yeah. The question is that just hearing the two syllables, ta, pa, how does that translate into meditation method and the goal of the meditation? What I understand about Sanskrit is that the syllables, they're alive. They have potency, just like table is stane, something like that. It means that which holds things up off the floor. So ta, pa, I'd assume that the syllables themselves inherently have some root vibration which will translate or transmit. I wonder if our Shastrik could say something about that.
Says the verse says it's number 16 and number 21 as the syllables of the Sanskrit. If you engage in devotional service, Krishna will give you the understanding of how to come to him. The method, the order of the spiritual master contains the potency to fulfill that order. So doing devotional service to Krishna, that automatically contains that you're going to get in connection with Krishna. He'll show the understanding. And you just continually apply that process, then inherently you'll get the result. He's a qualified hearer. He's a qualified servant. That's the qualification of being able to enter into this process of Shravanam Kirtan, is to have a qualified speaker and to be a qualified hearer. So the qualification comes due to sadhana siddha, through to our sadhana, kripa siddha, or nitya siddha. We're eternally perfect, or we have got the mercy of our spiritual master, or by following the sadhana very rigidly, strictly, with the proper consciousness, there's niyamagraha. We can follow the rules and regulations, but we're not inspired, we're not interested in getting a result. We just want to have rules and regulations so we can get in other people's cases. So if we're practicing and following sincerely, that's the qualification, that the seed of bhakti will fructify within our hearts. And it will produce those beautiful flowers and blossoms and fruits of love of Godhead. So the qualification, it's not just automatic, but the qualification has to be there. So to endeavor to develop that qualification, that should be our goal, rather than to try and find the result, work now, samadhi later, endeavor to become qualified. Purification. It's good to be confident that you understand, but humility encourages us to just reconfirm, to always, well, I was thinking like this. It's difficult to approach and to be humble and to ask proper questions, but to develop the proper attitude of how to ask questions in a self-effacing, like appealing, Prabhu, I understand you might have some greater understanding. Please confirm, enlighten. And often there are classes, and three questions are challenges, three questions are just establishing their own philosophy. I'm just running it past everybody, see, I can also, but the humble, sincere inquiry will get the most significant response. So it behooves us to learn how to ask questions, answers by citing the Lord's version, the Srimad Bhagavatam, to find out how to inquire and how to associate with devotees, how to humbly, but also, no nonsense. When you don't associate with somebody who's getting off on a tangent, you say, okay, thank you very much. So, thank you very much. Stay tuned for the next three verses of this Chatushloki. Urmashula Prabhupada Ki Jaya.